that men pray.
Yes, sir.
And pray without ceasing. Prayer is a lost process in the kingdom in so many regards. And we press to do everything but pray.
Amen.
And there was a time when Jesus went into the temple and drove men out of the temple and said, "My Father's house will be called the house of prayer." Amen. Not none of these catchy names that we slap on our face. He said it's going to be called the house of prayer. So whatever you call the place you worship, it better be a house of prayer.
That's right.
Amen. Amen. Glory to God. So we just want to talk about prayer today. We want to pray.
Amen.
Today.
Amen.
You'd be surprised how many people come to meetings that are supposed to be prayer. And they do everything but pray.
Come on,
Amen.
Right. Right about.
So we're going to talk about prayer, and we're going to pray as men of God in this place. Is that all right?
Amen.
We'll use for a foundational scripture Luke chapter 18. Luke chapter 18. And while you're locating the 18th chapter of Luke, we've given thanks and praise and glory to God. I also want to thank my brother Evangelist Brooks for this opportunity to share in this place and the great work that he has been doing and is doing, and by the grace of God will continue to do among men, women, and children in this community.
Amen.
Along with all that are attached to impact change.
Yeah.
Pastor Scott and Evangelist Keisha, Lord intercessor, amen. She does it all. Amen. However, God releases her.
Right.
And all those that are attached to impact change, we just thank God for the work that they're doing. I want to thank God for Prophet Colbert, Pastor Bolar, and Pastor Breedy, all of those that are here today from Turning Point that came, the men that came to share in the Word of God and to stand and pray as men of God. Amen. From this 18th chapter of Luke, beginning at the first verse, you should find these words. And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and faint not. And he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and faint not, saying, there was in a city a judge which feared not God, neither regarded man. And there was a widow in that city, and she came to him, saying, "Avenge me of my adversary." And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, "Though I fear not God, nor regard man, yet because this widow troubleth me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me, or she wear me out." And the Lord said, "Hear what the unjust judge saith. And shall not God avenge his own elect, which cry day and night unto him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth?" He spake a parable, saying, "Men ought always to pray and faint not." And the example he gave is a woman that continually pressed upon the judge that didn't fear God nor regard man. But this judge said, "Even though I don't fear God nor do I care anything about man, let me just go ahead and move on this woman's behalf. lest she wear me out. And so Jesus says men ought always to pray and faint not. Don't let up. Amen. Don't let up. Don't let up. Don't let up. God will move on your behalf. Men ought always to pray. Jesus says in the 16th chapter of Matthew, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. How many of you know we need the keys of the kingdom of heaven? Now take note of the fact he didn't say to the kingdom of heaven. He said of the kingdom of heaven. That means I'm going to give you the keys of heaven's operations. I'm going to show you how heaven operates so you can operate that way here on earth. Are y'all with me? It's sort of like if you were to run a franchise. You have an area and a territory. You don't need to get to headquarters. You just need to run the area and the territory that you've been assigned. If you have a McDonald's franchise or Burger King, and they will give you the keys of their operations. They will give you a big manual how to operate it. And the way we do things, it's a billion souls, so we don't need you reinventing nothing or coming up with nothing. This thing works. And so we're going to give you the keys of, we don't need you coming to headquarters trying to get to headquarters. We want you to handle this territory here. And we'll give you the keys of our operation. And if you follow the keys of our operation, you'll be successful where you are. Just like we're successful. How many of you know God got heaven on lock? God got heaven on lock. Everything in heaven and anything that tried to rise up in heaven was kicked out. So God don't need you coming to heaven. He needs you doing what he desire for you to do in the earth realm. We got too many people looking to go to heaven. Just when we all get to heaven, like heaven is the final destination. We even used to sing a song, heaven is my goal. Every day of my life, but heaven can't be your goal. Hey, because you're not staying anyway. You read the end of the book. The Bible says, John said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. And heaven descending down from God and heaven and earth coming together. So you coming back. That's not your destination. When God created man, there was no sin. There was no fall. There was no trespass. And he put man on earth because that's where he was. And he said, have dominion over the earth because that was God's intent. And so we coming back. So we need to be able to operate where and how God has set us as men in the earth. Amen. And he says, I'll give you the keys. I'll give you the keys of heaven's operation. Understanding the significance of keys. Keys give us access to things. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Keys give us control. Allow us to take control over things. And keys give us answers to things. And he says, I'm going to give you the keys of heaven's operation. Prayer is a mighty access key in the kingdom of God. In Hebrews, the 4th chapter, the Bible says, come boldly to the throne. Come boldly. You don't have to be reserved. You don't have to be timid. You don't have to wonder, is it okay to talk to God? Come boldly to the throne of grace that you may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. Prayer is a mighty access key. I need to hit this quick, y'all. Y'all got to get with it. Prayer not only gives us access to God, but it allows us control over things. You know, you got a key that gets you in your door, get you in your car door, that gets you access, right? But then you have to put the key in the ignition to gain control over the car. Not only does prayer give us access to the things of God, but it allows us control over our circumstances and situations in life.
Yes, sir.
The fourth chapter of Philippians says, be careful or anxious for nothing. I don't care what's going on. I don't care how frantic you feel right now. I don't care how it looks like the bottom is falling out of things now. I don't care if you can't figure out what to do or how to move. The book says, be anxious
for nothing.
Don't be concerned. Don't be in no panic concerning nothing. But by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God will keep your hearts and minds. The peace of God that surpasses all understanding will keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. I don't care how chaotic your situation, you can gain control over it simply by praying. Amen. It doesn't matter how bad things look. If you dare to pause and bring everything in and talk to God in Jesus' name, it will subdue the chaos in your life. And the book says, this peace that surpasses all understanding. That's what I love about the Lord. He gives you peace that surpasses all. So when it's chaotic and you don't understand, I'm going to give you a peace that surpasses understanding anyway. So don't try to figure it out. Don't try to, come on, don't try to have it make sense. Just trust God.
Yes, sir.
Oh, you know God have us doing things that don't make no sense.
Come on.
Tell a man to build an ark on dry land. You know that don't make no sense. Step out of the boat in the midst of a storm and walk. Jesus said, come. You know that don't make no sense. This peace surpasses all understanding. Not only does prayer give us access and allow us control over circumstances, but prayer gives us answers.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. Keys give us answers. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Answer keys.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Yes, sir. You've been to school. The teacher passed out a test to everybody, but she keep for herself.
Uh-huh.
The answer key.
Uh-huh.
Prayer is a mighty answer key for the kingdom of God. Jeremiah 33:3, God says, call unto me.
Yes.
Call unto me. Now, we know we can call unto him. But he goes on to say, and I'll answer you and show you great and mighty things that you know not, that you had not even began to embark upon. I'll show you things that you hadn't even thought about. That's why he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think. I'll show you things that you know not. Prayer is a mighty. Have you ever learned something in prayer?
Uh-huh.
Have you ever gotten an answer to something that you was looking for something else, but he began talking to you about something you wasn't even on?
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
He said, I'll show you great and mighty things that you know not.
Yeah, thank you, Lord.
Prayer gives us access. Prayer allows us control over. Prayer gives us answers when we need answers. Men and followers of the Most High God, I want you to know that we have been given a mighty access, control, and answer key through Christ to the full manifestation and glory here on earth. This awesome key that I'm referring to is the powerful privilege of prayer. Amen. The powerful privilege of prayer. Prayer is a privilege to be able to talk to the King of Glory is a privilege.
That's it.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
You got to make an appointment to go talk to the mayor.
Come on.
You got to get past security to talk to the president.
Come on.
But the King of Glory has given you the privilege to talk to him at any time about anything. And there's nobody at the door that you got to explain who you are to.
Yes, sir.
Come on in here, somebody.
Yes, sir.
All you got to do is go down and pray.
Yes, sir.
And God will meet you there.
Yes, yes.
This is a powerful privilege to talk to the King of Glory. How dare we forfeit the privilege of prayer? Just for a little bit, I want to talk about the importance of prayer among men. The power and importance of prayer among men, generally for the healing of the land. 2 Chronicles 7:14, the Bible says, if my people, you know what it says, would you call by my name, will humble themselves and
pray.
And if they will humble themselves and pray, seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from where I am. And I'll forgive their sins and I'll heal their land. He said, if my people, I'll heal their land. Now, how many of you know the land need healing?
Yes, sir.
In so many regards. On so many fronts, the land need healing.
Yes,
and God said, if my people would do something.
Yes, sir.
If my people would do something. He didn't say, if the drunk stop drinking, I'll heal the land. He didn't say, if the liar quit lying, I'll heal the land. He didn't say, if the thief quit stealing, I'll heal. He said, if my people would do something, I'll heal the land. So regardless of how bad the land is, the problem in the land is the people of God. Because God never left a sinner to do anything. The only option a sinner has is to accept Christ and get saved. But those who have accepted Christ have an obligation. He said, if my people, the onus is on us. Amen. I said the onus is on us. God never left it in the hands of anybody but those. If you would turn from your wicked ways. Why? Because you can. You got Christ.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
If I don't have Christ, I'm not turning. Come on, somebody.
Right.
You can't turn from your wicked ways if you don't have Christ. So he didn't leave it to those that don't have Christ to do anything but accept Christ.
Yes,
but those that have Christ, he said, now if you will turn from your wicked ways, because you can.
That's it.
If you turn from your wicked way, then I will heal. I'll heal the land. If my people. And so we got to do it together, y'all. He said, if my people. He didn't say if a certain person. Y'all hear me? He didn't say if a certain person. So we ain't waiting for our Moseses and our Pauls and our. If my people.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Lord.
We'll pray. I'll heal the land. Not only is prayer important generally for the healing of the land, but it's important personally for us in the removal of burdens and barriers in our life. Look at Matthew, the 21st chapter. Matthew chapter 21. Glory to God. Somebody say, let's pray.
Let's pray.
Matthew chapter 21, beginning at verse 21. Matthew chapter 21, verse 21. Jesus answered and said unto them, verily I say unto you, if you have faith and doubt not, you shall not only do this which is done to the fig tree, but also if you shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed. And be thou cast into the sea, it shall be done. And all things whatsoever you ask in prayer. In prayer, believing, you shall receive. So prayer is important for moving barriers and burdens in your life. He said, if you just say to this mountain in prayer, believing, be thou removed. Now, I know for a long time, those of us in church, we've been climbing up the rough side of the mountain.
Yes, sir.
Lord, help us today. Climbing up the rough side of the mountain, trying to get home.
Uh-huh.
And first off, if you're going to climb the mountain, thank God for the rough side.
Right, right.
Amen. Because you can't climb the smooth side of a mountain. But you complain about the rough side. Try climbing the smooth side. Hey, but if you're going to climb, and I'll be praying for you while you're climbing. I'll be praying your strength while you're climbing. But Jesus gave another option. He said, what you can do is speak to the mountain and say, be thou. I'm going to stay with the speaking part. But those that's going to climb, I thank God for your strength. I'm going to pray your strength. Amen. And thank God for the rough side. But what Jesus said is speak to the mountain. And if you have the faith, believing when you speak, it shall be done. Burdens and barriers can be moved out of your life if you speak to them. If you pray, believing, it shall be done. So not only is prayer important generally for all of us collectively for the healing of the land. And don't miss this, y'all. We can't just go out of here having heard that and then don't come together and pray for the land, because the onus is on us. And it's not about a one-time thing. Oh, they're going to be praying it over a sudden change on such and such date, and it goes away. Over here, so we have to position ourselves in prayer, and it has to be ongoing. It has to be ongoing. Satan got to know we're not going to stop this. Because if it's just going to be about January the 29th or April the 15th or August the 3rd, he'll wait.
Uh-huh.
He'll let you do what you do on them dates. Uh-huh. And I get with you on August the 4th.
Uh-huh. 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 Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But if it's going to be a floodgate of prayer ongoing.
Yes, sir.
Lord Jesus.
Ongoing and no ceasing. Then he don't have a window for his foolishness. And we have momentum to destroy everything on our path. How many of you know momentum is powerful?
Yes, sir.
Momentum is powerful.
Yes, sir.
You can tell when folk aren't praying because they ain't got no momentum. Any little thing can mess them up. Any little thing can trip them up. You know, a train, if you just put an inch block of wood in front of its wheel, it can't take off. That's why they sweep the tracks of dust and debris and little pebbles. But once it gets going and got momentum, it'll smash through a wall. Those little pebbles and little blocks are meaningless once it's going. So I know you ain't been praying. And I know you ain't got going. You don't have no momentum in any little thing. Us, you don't like. Any little thing can stop you. Any little thing can keep you from going because you ain't got no momentum. You got to pray without ceasing. And when you coming down the track in righteousness and the Spirit of God, any little foolishness that come on the track gets smashed on the track. I know I'm right about it. It's momentum.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
It's momentum. You got to get that Holy Ghost fire.
Yes, sir.
You got to get that fervor. You got to get that momentum going. And it'll smash every little piece of foolishness that come up in your life. So prayer is important. Generally for the healing of the land.
Yes, sir.
It's important personally for removing burdens and barriers out of our lives. Prayer is essential to results that are beneficial to man in this life. James chapter 5, The Bible says the effectual and fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. Don't you let the enemy convince you that praying is a waste of time. Don't you let him convince you that you've already prayed and didn't nothing happen. The devil is a liar. The Bible says the effectual and fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. That means produces much. That means it will accomplish much. I dare you to be steadfast in prayer. Amen. And unmovable. Your prayer work. Come on, say that with me. Say, my prayer work.
My prayer work.
My prayer work. My prayer work. My prayer work. The effectual and fervent prayer of the righteous will avail much. And not only does my prayer work, but our prayers work. When we pray together, when we come together, if my people that are called, our prayers work. It's essential, y'all, to knowing that you have real fellowship with God.
Yes, sir.
1 John 5:14 and 15, the Bible says, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, this is the confidence that we have. Anybody got confidence in God? Anytime you reserved or you're not sure about your prayer, Lord, if it be your will, you got to know his will. You need to search his will. You got to know it's his will that you be healed. You got to know it's his will that you be delivered. You got to know it's his will that you triumph over the works of the enemy. And you ain't got to say, if it be your will. You got, if you know it's his will, the book says this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, that he hears us. And if we know he hears us, then we know we have the petition that we desire of him. This is the confidence. This is the confidence. This is the confidence. When you know his will, that's because you got fellowship with him. Some of us need to restore our fellowship with the Father. The relationship may be intact, but the fellowship could be broken.
Come on, say that. Say it.
And that's what's missing among a lot of folk. And they keep saying, I need to develop my relationship with the Lord. You don't need to develop your relationship. If you're a child, you're a child.
Come on.
Amen.
Amen.
You may not speak to your cousin. You may not speak to your brother or your sister. You may not even be speaking to your parents. But they're not less your parents. Less your cousin. You sort of my cousin. You sort of my brother. No, they're not. The relationship is still, it's the fellowship
that's
broken. You're not less a child of God.
Amen.
I said you're not less a child of God.
Yes, sir.
Than anybody else or than ever you was. You still, if you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and if you still believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that God has raised him from the dead and that he died for your sin, you are no less a child of God.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Maybe the fellowship needs to be restored.
Yes, sir.
You've been out of fellowship with him, and you need to restore that fellowship, because when the fellowship is restored, glory to God.
Yes,
I said when the fellowship is restored,
yes, sir,
and you know the Father's will, this is the confidence you have in him, that when you ask anything according to his will, when you ask anything because you know this is the Father's desire, when you ask anything because you know he desired better for you, when you ask anything because you know he got a plan for your life, when you ask anything according to his will, you know you have the petition that you desire. Amen. Glory to God. It's essential, y'all.
Yes, sir.
And the enemy wants to cut off our prayers.
Yes, sir.
I said he want them cut off.
Yes.
He don't just want them slowed up.
Yes.
He want them cut off.
Yes, sir.
He don't come to play with you or just to aggravate you or just to upset you. Mm-hmm. Or just to get on your back and get on your nut. No, the enemy comes for no other reason but to kill, to steal, destroyed.
Yes, sir.
If it's not destroyed, if it ain't all gone, if it ain't dead, he ain't finished.
Come on.
Did you hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Your little attitude ain't nothing. You upset and you distraught. You still breathing. So he ain't finished. I said, you're still breathing, so he ain't finished. He come to steal, kill, and destroy. So as long as there's breath in your body, he's coming after you. He's coming for you. He don't care about your misery. He don't care that you're down. He will kick you while you're down because he comes to kill, steal, and destroy as long as you have breath. As long as you have breath. But I got a remedy. Because the book says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. And so if you will take that breath and bless God, if you take that breath and glorify his name, knowing that the enemy has still got you up for you up, but if you take that breath and bless the Lord, oh my soul, and I take that breath and glorify him, and you'll see God glorified in your life. The enemy wants our prayers cut off, and because he wants our prayers cut off, he wants us to regard iniquity. Look at Psalm 66. Psalm 66. My God. Prayer is too powerful and essential. Psalm 66. Somebody say, get there, Bishop.
Get there.
We there. Amen. Verse 17. I cried unto him with my mouth, and he was extolled with my tongue. But if I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. If I regard iniquity in my heart, if I regard sin in my heart, he will not hear me. Satan wants us to regard sin. Consider. Approve. And you know, sometimes we say things and we snare ourselves. I know what I can do about that. That's regarding iniquity in your heart. Oh, you don't want the old me. Why are you giving regard to the old you? That's who was taking you to hell. That's who you needed deliverance from. That's who you cried unto the Lord about, the old you. Now they don't want the old you, and you don't want the old you either.
Come on, Bishop.
If I regard, I'm asking God about something, but I'm thinking about something else. Mm-hmm. I'm asking God about something, but if he don't move when I think he ought to move, then I won't wait on Isaac. I'll go ahead and make an Ishmael.
Come on.
If I regard iniquity in my heart, the book says he won't hear me. And John said, the confidence that we have in him is that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us.
Jeremiah
said, call unto me and I'll answer you. But if I regard, consider, approve iniquity in my heart, he will not hear me.
Good.
The enemy wants to jam up our prayers with the consideration of iniquity,
right?
Doubt and disbelief will hinder our prayers, y'all. James chapter 1, around that 6 to 8 verse, the Bible says a man wavering is like a wave driven with the wind and tossed. And look at here. It says, let not that man think he shall receive anything.
Yes, sir.
Let not that man think that he shall receive anything.
Yes, sir.
Of the Lord. For a double-minded man is unstable in all, not just some of his ways, but in all. So a man that is wavering, a man that is trusting God sometimes and trying to figure it out other times, a man that starts out with the Lord, but want to take off. You ever been with somebody that sleep? If y'all going out of town somewhere, they sleep the whole ride. And then when you get in town and get wet, they want to wake up. Turn here. Lord, how you think we got this far?
Come on.
Now you want to get to, listen, how you think you got this far? God don't need you to, come on, somebody. God don't need you to wake up and take the wind. You can't start out with God.
Yeah.
And then just because it looks like you're close and it ain't moving like you want to take over. You better stay with the Lord. Tell somebody, stay with the Lord. Stay with the Lord. Let him drive. Let him keep the wheel. Let him keep the wheel. Amen. He don't need no backseat drive, no side drive. The Lord can get you there.
Yes, sir.
If we trust in him,
yes,
if we stay faithful to him,
yes, sir.
And doubt not. A man that's wavering, a man that's wavering, he don't know where he want to. He over here 1 week and next week he's somewhere else. He believe in this 1 week and next week he believe in something else. He with this group of people 1 week and he over here with this group. And a man that's wavering. The book says it's like the wind, driven with the wind and tossed. Let not that man think that he shall receive anything from the Lord. Why? Because the Lord can't trust you. You don't even trust yourself.
That's it.
Tossed. Confused. Unstable in all his ways. God ain't gonna give you nothing because you're unstable in all your ways. A double-minded man. You gotta make up your mind. That's what Joshua said. Right before they went into their inheritance, he brought Israel together. He said, now y'all don't see what God did to our enemies. Anybody seen God do something to your enemies in your life?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Have you seen God turn some things around in your life?
Yes, sir.
Have you seen God plummet darkness in your life?
Yes, sir.
Joshua said, now y'all seen what God did to our enemies on the other side of Jordan. But I see some of y'all wrestling with whether to serve God or Baal. He said, if God be God, serve him. If Baal, serve him. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. You might have to say, as for me in this house, I will serve. Or as for me in spite of this house. But you got to make up in your own mind. If God be God, that you're going to serve him.
Yes, sir.
Because a double-minded man is unstable at all his ways. Let God be true and every man be a liar. I dare you to check out a double-minded man. He ain't just unstable in his faith and belief. He's unstable in his money. He is unstable in his relationship. He's come on, somebody.
Come on. That's it.
In all his ways. And so the enemy wants you wrestling tossing in doubt and unbelief. And I appreciate the man in the 9th chapter of Mark when Jesus says, if thou can believe, all things are possible. And the book says, he said with tears in his eyes, I believe, but help thou. I don't want to be found unstable. I believe, but help thou my unbelief. Help me with these experiences that I got. I believe. But this ain't the first time I seen somebody go in the hospital and not come out. I believe. This ain't the first time I prayed about something and it didn't get better, it got worse. I believe. This ain't the first time that I looked for something to change and it didn't change when I thought. I believe, but help thou. Help me in these experiences that I got that want to keep creeping up in my mind. Help thou my unbelief. And Jesus had mercy on the man and delivered his son. Anybody can say, I believe. But I got some experiences that try to challenge what God said. I believe. But I got some experiences that try to challenge me on the word. I believe. But Father, help thou my unbelief. And watch God pour out his spirit on you and inundate you with his Holy Spirit. And the places where you can't pray, the Holy Ghost will make groanings and utterances that cannot be uttered. I know right about it. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. But if in all your ways, you will acknowledge him, he will. He'll direct your path. But you gotta acknowledge him in all your ways. Not just in the ways where his righteousness is, but even in those other ways. If you would just acknowledge him. If you would, even in those other ways, those ways where you go stray, if you would still acknowledge God, he'll begin to walk you away from him. But see, we don't acknowledge him in those ways. We shun him. We ignore him. But if you would just acknowledge him, even if you're stumbling, acknowledge him. Even if you're going to stumble, acknowledge him. Because you cannot keep acknowledging him and stay that way. You cannot, I said you cannot keep acknowledging him and stay. If you will acknowledge him, I'm about to take this drink, but God, I know you, I'm about to do that, but God, I dare you to keep acknowledging him. See, Satan wants you to ignore him and dismiss him so you can freely do what you do. But if you acknowledge him, I'm not saying you ain't going to mess up, but I'm saying you're going to walk away from that thing. That thing is going to be in your past. It's going to break off of you if you dare to keep acknowledging him. His presence is too powerful for you to be in and sin to reign. His presence is too powerful for you to be in and anything that's not pleasing to stay in his presence. I dare you to acknowledge him. And he will direct your prayer, your path. Unforgiveness hinders our prayers, y'all. In the 11th chapter of Mark, Jesus said, ask anything you want, and it'll be done of the Father. But he goes on to say, and when you stand praying, forgive. And when you stand praying, forgive. Because if you don't forgive others, the Father will not forgive you. When you stand praying, he talks about all of the blessedness of praying and asking and receiving. But then he says, now when you stand praying, forgive. Unforgiveness holds you hostage to the circumstances of your past. It's not for them, it's for you. Un- unforgiveness don't hold the one that trespassed against you hostage. It holds you hostage. Yeah. Hostage to the pain, hostage to the shame or the anger and the rage. It keeps your womb open. I said unforgiveness keeps your wounds open. And it causes you to bleed on folk that didn't cut you.
Right.
Y'all. And you wonder why folk don't want to be around you, why they don't stay around, and they don't understand what I've been, because you bleed on folk that didn't cut you. Unforgiveness keeps the wounds open.
That's it.
But when you finally figure out that whatever they did, whatever happened,
yes, sir,
it don't matter as it relates to the plan and destiny of God for your life, you can let it go. You can let it go. Satan wants you thinking that it still matters. That's why I still hurt. Satan wants you to think it still matters. That's why I still hard to think about. Satan wants you to think that it still matters. But when you understand it don't matter. It don't change. God says, I know the plans and the thoughts that I have concerning you, and what they did don't matter. I know the plans and the thoughts that I have concerning you, and what happened don't matter. I know the plans and the thoughts that I have concerning you, and what you've been through, it don't matter as it relates to what I still have in store for you. And so unforgiveness holds you hostage and not them. Because there's times when you have to remind folk of what they did. They done went on with their lives. They done moved on. They done went on past it. And you're the only one still in that prison of the circumstance of the past. And it hinders your prayers. Because it caused you to bleed on folk that didn't cut you. It caused you to be unbearable. And I don't trust nobody. And I just got it for me. And that's exactly what Satan wants you. Isolated. Locked in the pit with just you and him. Unforgiveness hinders your prayers. When you stand praying, forgive. And finally, for those that are married, disregard of your spouse. Look at 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3. We're going to pray in a minute, y'all. 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3. First Peter chapter 3, verse number 7. The Bible says, likewise, ye husbands, dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life. Why? That your prayers be not hindered. Likewise, ye husband, dwell with them according to knowledge. According to knowledge, so that your prayers don't be hindered. When you disregard your spouse, it hinders your prayers. When you disregard your spouse, it hinders your prayer. God will not allow you to carry on like that. Not in his name. I said not in his name. When you disregard, that is to have no real consideration. God is requiring you to have great consideration for their feelings and for their needs. And when you disregard their feelings and their needs, it hinders your prayer. God will not allow you to carry on that way in his name. God will not betray his daughter like that.
Come on.
I said, God will not betray his daughter like that. So dwell with them according to knowledge. Dwell with them, the book says, according to knowledge. Ain't nobody got no business knowing your woman better than you. Dwell with them according to knowledge. No, nobody got any business understanding their needs, but dwell with them according to knowledge. You want them to know you and know what you and know your and the book says for you to dwell with them according to knowledge. So that you'll respond like you're supposed to. And your prayers don't get hindered. Satan wants your pride all twisted. He wants your pride all messed up in regard to your spouse. So that you will disregard them and get your prayers hindered. Men, we got to know what God's will is.
Amen.
Because prayer is too powerful. I said prayer is too powerful. Prayer is too important to be hindered among men. Amen. Satan wants your prayers hindered. Hell is on assignment to disrupt and derail the prayers of men in the earth. And our prayers are powerful, and the enemy wants them hindered. When positioned properly in prayer, we possess the potential to perform every purpose of God and prevail over every problem both life and the enemy sets on our path. Did you hear me?
Yes,
I said when positioned properly in prayer, we possess the potential to perform every purpose of God and prevail over every problem that both life and the enemy sets on our path. That's when positioned properly in prayer. So we got to be ready to pray, y'all. We got to be willing to pray. James, the 5th chapter. The Bible says that the prophet Elijah had like desires just like we are, was human just like we are. Same human desires, same limitations as any other man, but he prayed. He prayed, and for the space of 3 years, there was not rain on earth. And then he prayed again, and a great mighty outpouring of rain came upon the earth. And he wasn't nothing different than you. The prophet Elijah was human like we are, the same human desires and limitations as any other man, but he prayed. Same desires and limitations as any other man, but he was a praying man. And he prayed, and there was no rain on the earth for 3 years. And he prayed again, and the heavens opened up. It wasn't because he was special. It wasn't because he had something that you don't have. It wasn't because he didn't desire certain. It was because he was a praying man.
Yes, sir.
And if you would dare to pray, I hear the sound of the abundance of rain.
Yes, sir.
I hear the sound of the abundance of rain. All across this land, men coming together, understanding that they are powerfully positioned to prevail over the enemy. I hear the sound of the abundance of rain, a great outpouring of righteousness and power to prevail in the earth, advancing the kingdom of God. I hear the sound of the abundance of rain.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. I dare you to open up your spirit and listen in the heavenlies and see the people of God coming together, understanding that he said, if my people that are called by my my name. God is gathering and rounding his troops, and you don't want to be outside the arena of what God is doing in this. I hear the sound of the abundance. Oh, I'm not talking about a drip. I'm not talking about a drizzle. The abundance of rain. Somebody say, open up the floodgates, God. Open up the floodgates. Open up the floodgates of hell. Come on, say it like me. Open up the floodgates of heaven. I hear the sound of the abundance of rain. If you trust him in prayer. If you trust him in prayer. If you trust him in prayer. If you know, if you have this confidence, then let us pray. Let us pray. Let us bombard the heavens. Amen. With thunderous prayer. Trust in God. Let us pray. Now, there's a lot of teaching going on. I've read a lot of books that talk about 9 kinds of prayer. But I want you to understand there are 4 kinds of prayer. And 5 parts to prayer. It's 4 kinds of prayer. 4 kinds of prayer. Personal and secret prayer. There's family prayer. There's group prayer. And there's public prayer. Those kinds of prayer. You can pray personally and in secret. Lord says, when he was teaching his disciples to pray, you remember they said, teach us to pray. Because they were so impressed with the Pharisees. Pharisees would stand and pray long, and they had all this stuff written on their tassels and whatnot, and they would stand there, and they'd make a long prayer. And Jesus said, when you pray, first of all, do not vain repetitions like the Pharisees, because they think they will be heard because of their much speaking. But the Father knows what you have need of before you ask. So don't stand there with a whole bunch of over and over and over. Don't do that. He said, when you stand praying, don't do a bunch of vain repetitions. God is not impressed with you keep saying the same thing, keep asking, and keep on. Come on, somebody. I remember when we were young, we used to go to, the name changed to Americana, but when we were going, it was called the Swordsville Lake. It was a long drive. We had chicken in the car.
Yeah.
It was a long drive, but we was going to the amusement park. We'd be out. Daddy, we there yet? We there yet? You ask me one more time, I'm gonna turn this car around. I said, we going. Treat me like I don't keep my word. Treat me like I don't know where I'm going. That's how we treat God. We treat God like he don't keep his word. Like you don't know what Jesus said, don't do the vain repetitions. Like the Pharisees who think they're gonna be heard because of their much speaking. And then you ain't got to say all of the different lofty titles that they give God before they pray. The great like that's going to get his attention. Jesus said, when you pray, don't do vain repetitions like them who think they ain't going to be heard for their much speaking. But when you pray, say,
Our Father.
Our Father. Our Father. Because you're introducing a concept that nothing else in the world understood about God. They knew he was God. And they knew he was the authority. They knew he was the power. They knew he was the creator. But they didn't relate to him as Father. Amen, somebody. The power and the creator and the great one and the most high is my
Father.
He said, when you pray, they can say what they want to say, but when you pray, say, Our Father, which art in heaven. He gave the disciples the recipe and the model for prayer. And so there are four kinds of prayer: personal and secret prayer, family prayer. You need to pray with your family. Group prayer, like what we're doing in here tonight, today. Group prayer. Groups pray. And then there's public prayer. Sometimes we need to go into city squares and out in public and pray. So whether there's personal prayer, family prayer, group prayer, or public prayer, those four kinds of prayer make up how the different ways that we pray, but there are five parts to prayer that make up our prayer. Just like there are several parts to a conversation. Is that right? A conversation may start out with a greeting, and then there's the discussion. Sometimes it includes expressions of gratitude. Amen. And then sometimes there's goodbyes. However you do it. Some conversations just include the discussion. Don't even say hi. I need to talk to you. This conversation ain't even gonna get no greeting. And some of them, the goodbyes, hand gestures.
My Lord. My Lord.
There are different parts to a conversation. So it is with prayer. There are different parts to prayer. And some of the prayer contained some of the parts, several of the parts, maybe just one part. But there are five parts to prayer. And we're going to pray today, y'all. Five parts to prayer. There's adoration. There's confession. There's supplication. There's intercession. And there's thanksgiving. Four kinds of prayer. Five parts to the conversation. And sometimes we just do some of them. But we pray. There's adoration. Somebody say adoration.
Adoration.
There's confession. Say confession.
Confession.
There's supplication. Say supplication.
Supplication.
There's intercession.
Intercession.
And thanksgiving.
And thanksgiving.
Come on, say it again. Adoration.
Adoration.
Confession.
Confession.
Supplication.
Supplication.
Intercession.
Intercession.
Thanksgiving.
Thanksgiving.
Adoration.
Adoration.
Confession.
Confession.
Supplication.
Supplication.
And thanksgiving.
Thanksgiving.
Adoration is profound reverence expressed. It's intense love and admiration. It's an unshakable confidence. Adoration. Adoration. And among men, adoration has been lost. Men don't know how to just adore God. Some may feel weak because they're lavishing adoration on God, but I want you to know it's powerful to adore him. It's powerful to adore him. In the book of Revelation, it talks about the elders casting down their crown, saying, "Worthy is the Lamb to receive glory." And they lavished their adoration on him. There was a thief hanging on the cross. Both sides, there was thieves hanging on the side of Jesus. And one thief said, that had no adoration, said, "If you be the Christ, come down and save us." And the other one, the Bible says, "Do not you fear God? Do not you fear God? We are receiving what we deserve, but he has done nothing wrong." And he said, "Lord, when you enter into your kingdom, remember me." Do not you fear God? That's reverence. Lord, when you enter your kingdom, Lord, that's admiration, y'all. I said, that's admiration, because at this time, Jesus was beat to a bloody pulp. He was hanging to his death. Blood streaming down. And he looked at this man beat to a bloody pulp, looking defeated, and called him Lord. Glory to God. Can y'all see that? I mean, he looked defeated. He looked like it was over. This the fourth quarter and you're down by 20. He didn't, but yet he looked at him like the game wasn't over. He said, Lord. And then he expressed a great confidence. He said, when you enter your kingdom, remember me. When we learn how to adore him, y'all. Come on, prophet. When we learn how to adore him, when we learn how to adore him, we'll see things change in our life. When we learn how to lavish our adoration on him. Y'all ready to pray? Y'all ready to pray? Y'all look like y'all ready to pray. I said, are y'all ready to pray? When you learn how to lavish your adoration on him, it will change things. He looked at this man that was hanging to his death and looked like all his enemies had defeated him. And he looked at him, a bloody pulp, and said, Lord, can you look at your circumstances and look at things that look like it's not going right? That you might feel like you in the fourth quarter and down by 20 points, but can you still call him Lord? Can you still call him? Do you still believe he's in control? Come on, say Lord.
Lord.
Come on, say Lord.
Lord.
Come on, say Lord.
Lord.
I love you.
I love
Lord,
Lord,
I adore you.
Lord,
Lord, I adore you.
Lord,
Lord, I adore you. It looks ugly right now, but I adore you. It's dark right now, but I adore you. Glory to God. Come on, stand to your feet just for about 5 minutes. We're gonna lavish our adoration on him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Come on, get your hearts ready. Glory to God, 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 glory to God.
Your name is excellent in all the earth. You are high and lifted up, and your train fills the temple. We bless your name, God. You are glorious and wonderful and excellent, oh God. We find you altogether lovely. We kiss your feet, oh God. We bow before your throne. We recognize that you sit between the cherubim. Your eye and lifted up, and your train fills the temple. How excellent is your name in all the earth. You set your glory above all the heavens. Glory to your name. Glory to your name. Glory to your name. Glory to your name. You're a wonderful counselor. You're an excellent God. You are the Father of many nations. Blessed is your name, O God. Blessed is your name. None like unto you. You are incomparable. Blessed be your name, God. Blessed be your name, Lord. Blessed be your name. You are Lord. Even Lord forevermore. Blessing and glory. Honor and power, majesty and dominion belong to you, O God. It belongs to you. It belongs to you. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you. God on my circuit. We adore your presence. Your presence is sweet. Your spirit is sweet, oh God. We love you. Cast our crowns into feet. Our offices, our titles are beneath you, oh God. We recognize that you lifted up. Our hearts are filled with admiration for you, God. Nobody like you. Nobody like you, God. You are the blessed one. You are the holy one. You are the righteous one. Blessed is your name. Blessed is your name. Blessed is your name. Blessed is your name, God. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. We love you, Lord. We embrace you. Even in this moment, even in this moment, even in this place, Lord. We pray in the name of Jesus that you would manifest yourself and iterate yourself in the lives of these men in dimensions they have not experienced yet. Bring them to another place, oh God. Bring them to another place according to your spirit. Bring them to another place according to your will, according to your purpose. Cause their eyes to be opened that they might see and identify you as the great God who has no comparison. In the name of Jesus, we receive it right now. Say that. We receive it in Jesus' name. Say it again. We receive it in Jesus' name. We receive it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Put your hands together and give me praise.
Adore him, lavish our adoration on him, but we gotta confess. We gotta be able to confess our sin. 1 John chapter 1, the Bible says, if we say we have no sin, we lie and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us. He's faithful and just to forgive us. He's faithful. Now, this isn't a time to talk about what you ain't gonna do no more. This is a time to say, God, I need you. God, I need you. Don't let the enemy convince you into talking about what you ain't gonna do no more and what you ain't, because when you stumble, then he can kick you while you're down. Just let God already know. Just let him know that I need you right now. Before I take the next step, before I turn the corner, before I move further, I need you right now. I confess my sin before you right now. I lay it at your throne right now. Forgive us, Lord, the sins of commission. Amen. Those things that I keep doing, that I said I would not do. The sins of omission, those things that I said I would do, but I keep leaving them undone. Forgive us, Father. Forgive us, Father. Forgive us, Father. I need you right now. I need your spirit right now. Pour out your spirit, Lord. Pour out your spirit, Lord. Help my unbelief, Lord. Help my unbelief, Lord. Those places where I doubted you, where I let fear paralyze me. Help thou my unbelief. Forgive us, Lord. 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 As men all over this place is crying out to you, Father, purge them of every unrighteous thought. Purge them of every unrighteous act. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for helping me with the next step. I don't gotta look all the way down the road. Just help me with the next step. 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 In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. There is therefore no condemnation. There is therefore no condemnation. There is therefore no condemnation in them that love the Lord. dear God. We can be convicted, but we cannot be condemned. We can be convicted. We can be convicted and brought to a place of repentance, but we will never be cast out. We will never be cast aside. We will never be thrown away. There is no condemnation. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We who adore you confess our sins before you. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Not only is there adoration and confession, but there is supplication. There is supplication. The Bible says you have not because you ask not.
He tried to offer me something. You want to wrong? Taught me a valuable lesson. He taught me a value. You ask yourself. Quit putting him up to stuff. Quit putting him up to stuff. You ask yourself. And sometimes God wants you to ask yourself.
Yes, sir.
It's okay to ask people to pray with you sometimes, but sometimes God wants you to ask yourself. He wants you to come to him yourself. Make supplication yourself. Ask yourself. Love on him yourself. Ask what you will. Ask for that deliverance. Ask for that breakthrough. Ask God to help you in your home to be the spouse that you are set to be. Ask God to help you be the parent that you need to be. Ask God to help you to be the man that you know you ought to be. Ask yourself. Ask yourself. Ask yourself. Ask yourself. Watch God move in your life. Ask yourself. Ask yourself. Make supplication to him yourself. Just lift your hand right now and say, bless me indeed. Bless me indeed. It's me, Lord. It's me that's standing in the need of prayer. It's me, Lord. It's me that's asking. It's me that's calling on you. You know what I need. You know how I need it. It's me, God. It's me, God. It's me, God. Ask yourself, bless me indeed. Bless me indeed. Jabez prayed the prayer and he said, Lord, bless me indeed.
Yes, sir.
Enlarge my territory. Strengthen me. Make wide my borders. Help me to leave an inheritance for my children. Bless me indeed. 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 We don't get tired of praying. Bless me indeed. Bless me indeed. Bless my finances. Bless me indeed. Bless my mental health. I need to be able to handle the chaos around me. Bless me indeed. Strengthen me in my spirit. I need to speak the words of God. I need to stand on the word of God. I need to know how you're moving and when you move. Bless me indeed. Inundate me with your presence that I represent you everywhere I go. Bless me indeed. Bless me indeed. Bless me indeed. Bless me indeed. Not only do we adore you and we confess our sins, we trust you, God, with our petitions. And we know that you hear us. And we have the petition that we give before you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God, glory to God. He's doing it, he's doing it, he's doing it, he's doing it. He's doing it, he's doing it right now. The Bible says, when you start praying, believe, 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 believe. You got to see your children prosper. And I don't care if they're in jail right now. I don't care if they're in the streets right now. I don't care if they're selling drugs. You got to see them prospering. You got to see them in the kingdom. You got to see them in the kingdom. You got to see you and your spouse working together. I don't care if y'all ain't talking right now. I don't care if they ain't answering your call. I don't care if you're separated. Watch God move because a man stood up and said, bless me indeed. 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 Enlarge my borders, Lord. I gotta leave an inheritance for my son. The Bible says that if we don't leave an inheritance for our children, we're worse than an unbeliever. We're worse than an infidel. We're worse than an infidel. Enlarge my borders.
Keep your hand upon
me. Enlarge my borders. Enlarge my borders. Enlarge my borders in ministry. God, I want to reach the masses for you. Enlarge my borders. Fill my mouth with blood that I might speak the oracles of God. Enlarge my territory. Glory to God, 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 glory to God. We adore you. We confess our sin. We make supplication unto you, God.
We stand for God and we say,
we make supplication unto you, God. 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 Glory to your name, Lord. Glory to your name, Lord. Glory to your name, Lord. Glory to you. Come on in, come on in, come on in. Don't get tired. To Lord, and we out of here. Not only do we admire,
come on, Charlotte,
sing and confess and put our petition before him. We gotta make intercession, y'all. Yeah, we pray for ourselves, but we gotta make intercession for one another. We gotta stand with one another. We gotta care about one another. We gotta look after one another. We gotta stand with one another. We all know the story of Job. Bible says, opens up talking about Job offering just in case prayers.
Yes, sir.
God said he was an upright man. And Job said, it might be that my sons sinned against God and cussed God in their heart. I don't know about it. Let me offer another sacrifice. He offered just in case prayers for us. So he did everything right according to the book and according to church and all that. But I'm gonna cut through the chase. The Bible says in the last chapter, God turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Y'all see that? He offered just in case prayers for his family and his circle and his. But the Bible says God turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Agree with me.
God said, they have not said the thing that is right concerning me. And they're in jeopardy. And Job, I need you to pray for them, lest I do something to them. And God turned Job's captivity when he prayed for them. Job was proud of himself. In that 23rd chapter of Job, he said, oh, I wish I could see the days when I washed my steps in butter and young men ran away from me, and all men stood up, and the eye gave witness to me, and the ear leaned in to hear me. I was somebody.
Let's do it one more time.
But he says in that 16th chapter, I was at ease, and he has taken me by my name. I was at ease. A whole lot of folk are at ease because everything going right in their family. All their kids going to school. They don't pray for other kids no more. Their marriage is all right. They don't come to the meetings to pray for marriage. They don't come. They don't do anything after because they're doing so well. Job said, I was doing well. I was at ease. And he has taken me by my neck and set me up for his mark. But God turned his captivity when he prayed for his friends. Some of us are in trouble because we're at ease and we don't care about what's going on with somebody else. Amos said, woe unto you that are at ease in Zion, and do not cry for the affliction of Joseph. You don't know what's going on in his life. Just stretch a hand toward one of your brothers and just say, God bless him. God bless him. God bless him. God heal him. God deliver him. God give him a breakthrough. God work in his home. God work in his family. God move on his behalf. God lift him up. God turn him around. I release his mind from the trauma and the chaos that's going on. God bless him. 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 God strengthen him. Help him to stand in this hour. Do it for your name's sake. Help my brother. 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 Deliver my brother. Deliver my brother. Deliver my brother. In the name of Jesus, I declare healing. In the name of Jesus, I see you victorious. I see you soaring. I see you walking in power. I see you triumphing over every circumstance of life. In the name of Jesus. 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 Jesus told Peter, same desire to have you. Same desire to have you. Same desire to have you. And to sift you like wheat. He didn't say, I'm not going to let it. He said, but I pray for you. I pray for you. I pray for you. I pray for you. He didn't say I ain't gonna let him try. He didn't say I ain't gonna let him tempt him. He didn't say I ain't gonna let him come up against you. He said I pray for you. Glory to God. Glory to God. He gonna come again and he don't trust you, he challenged God, he gonna challenge you, but I dare you to keep praying for each other. 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 When you see one another, just hug their neck and say, I love you, man, I'm praying for you. I love you, man, I'm praying for you. Even if they smile, tell them, I love you, man, I'm praying for you. Because sometimes we smile through our tears. Sometimes as men, we smile through our tears and we hold things in. But sometimes if a man just say, I love you, man, and I'm praying for you, it will break, it will release something.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Glory to God.
Yes, sir.
Glory to God. Not only do we adore him and confess our sins, and stand and make supplication to him, knowing that we're his sons. We're his sons. Don't forget you're his son. All of those titles that you give God, that's all wonderful because he's all that. But don't forget you're his son.
Yes.
You're his son. And there's nothing you're going to do that will shock him or push him away from you. Make confession and supplication. Intercede for one another. But then finally, Thanksgiving. And I'm going to ask Pastor Scott to come back and do that prayer of Thanksgiving that he did earlier. Y'all wasn't here. Y'all wasn't here. Some of y'all wasn't here. We're going to thank God for his goodness, y'all. We're going to thank God for his loving kindness. We're going to thank God for his mercy toward us. Sometimes you just got to say thank you. Sometimes you just got to say thank you. You don't need a whole bunch, a whole lot of other stuff. Just say thank you. Just say thank you. Jesus took two fish and five barley loaves.
Yes, sir.
And looked at 5,000 people. And said, the Bible says, and when he had given thanks. When he had, have you ever took what looked like insufficient funds?
Come on, Bishop.
And said, thank you.
Come on. Come on. Come on.
Thank you. Thank you. He took insufficient funds and said, thank you. And the book says he break it. And 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 break it. Until everybody was satisfied. If you learn how to be thankful, he will break you off something that will satisfy your life. Come on, just start saying thank you. Come on, just start saying thank you. Thank you, Lord. Just start saying thank you. Before it happens, say thank you. You done already asked for it, say thank you. So you got to see your children soaring, say thank you. You got to see your home flourishing, say thank you. You got to see your walk with him getting stronger, say thank you. You got to see ministry moving according to God's will and advancing his kingdom, and say thank you. Say thank you. Say thank you. Come on, Pastor. Say thank you. Thank you.
That's right. Go ahead. Tell him thank you. He said it into his gates with what? What you going to enter into his gates with?
Thanksgiving.
You haven't even got it yet. Come on, somebody. You haven't even got your miracle. You haven't even got your healing. You haven't even got your blessing. You haven't even got your promotion. But guess what? Before I even get it, I'm coming with a spirit of what? Thanksgiving. So we gotta be thankful today for everything he's done, everything he said, every word that's been uttered, every prophecy that's been decreed. We're gonna thank God ahead of time. We're gonna ahead of time bless him. Ahead of time thankfulness of God. God, we just say